So, Father, we pray that you'll bless the time now that Bernard speaks to us. Speak by your Spirit, Lord. Hallelujah. Mm. New things, fresh things, whatever you want to speak, Lord. We do open our hearts and look forward to this now. Thank you, Father.
Yes,
Lord. We pray all these things in Jesus, who loves us and died for us.
Amen.
Amen. Mm. Amen.
Mm.
Here we are, ready to listen.
Shall I begin by reading something from Wesley again? You remember maybe, was it last week or whenever it was, maybe I quoted a hymn of Wesley's from a book, and I think BB put a connection up on the chat bit. But anyway, I just want to read one verse. This is from a hymn about passing through all kinds of things. And it begins, the first line of the hymn is, "Head of thy church triumphant, we joyfully adore thee, till thou appear, thy members here shall sing like those in glory." And then he proceeds to write some verses about the different things that people pass through, that the church passes through, in the which his theme really is, we can still sing like those in glory. And so here's the verse that came to my mind. Thou dost conduct thy people through torrents of temptation. Nor will we fear while thou art near the fire of tribulation. The world with sin and Satan in vain our march opposes. Through thee we shall break through them all and sing the song of Moses. So thou dost conduct thy people through torrents of temptation. It's a great verse that often comes to my mind. While thou art near the fire of tribulation, the world with sin and Satan in vain our march opposes. Through thee we shall break through them all and sing the song of Moses. And great hymn. So first line is, "Head of thy church triumphant," if you want to dig it out on the net sometime. But I've had conversations with, let me think, at least four leaders from different countries of churches, pastors of churches, facing certain things in their different countries. Some of the conversations, an hour or an hour and a half, we should be thankful for things like WhatsApp and Viber, and where we can talk to people freely, and it's not costing us an arm and a leg. But, you know, men going through times in their lives, and there was a prayer time that I was in this week as well with men, again, most of them leaders from several countries. And during the course of the prayer time, one of the brothers prayed with tears, and he used a phrase realizing that God really wasn't interested in his ministry primarily. And this led to a prophetic word toward the end of the prayer time, when the Lord spoke about journeying into God, that the primary thing that he wants to do with us all is that we journey into God, that we journey into his heart the more. Ministry, gifting, is a byproduct, only enriched, only deepened, only of profound value, or more profound value, as the man himself journeys into God, or the woman herself journeys further, further, further into God. And, you know, I've been spending many months actually in the prophets and pondering things, reading how God took his men in the Old Testament. You know that the world is not very challenged by the church nowadays. You know how, say in North America, certainly in this country, the word is weak. The Archbishop of Canterbury spoke in the last day or two, and oh dear, there's no challenge, nothing really that's coming from the heart of God that you can really hear. It's amazing. And it challenges us all. And so I want to kind of spread, I think I want to paint a picture and about prophecy, about real ministry, about real preaching, about the real word. You know, I don't know whether you have thought much about the actual state of people in this country where I am, in Europe, whether you've thought much about the state of people in Canada, the rank and file, the people, the politicians, high and low. If you could use a word to describe the states of people in the world around you, I wonder what word that you would use. I could think of several words. One of the words I would say is thoroughly dull. Dull. Another word I'd use is numb. The world is numb. Another word I'd use is indifferent. They're indifferent to, you know, it's an amazing state of affairs. You know, that the devil's work in society, it's incredible. And we can blame politicians, and we can go on about left and right. Oh, but I tell you, totalitarianism, as it is emerging in the 20th and in the 21st century, fascism's done, communism's done, but totalitarianism is not done. And it's emerging. It's a religion. It captures its followers, and it makes them stupid. Makes them stupid. The followers of the sexual gender, this is and that's, and the others, and the others, and the others. Whatever you want to say, it is stupidity. Like happened in Germany. How stupid people became when they followed Nazism. And there was no reasoning with them. There's no reasoning with someone who's become a fool, stupid and drunk with an idea. And, you know, it makes me, I think of it in the churches too, you see, that I realize so many are not journeying into God in the churches. They're not. They're not going into God any deeper. Christianity to them is basically the Lord Jesus. Saviorhood means that he's taken care of our sin problem. That's the penalty for it. That's just as far as they get. But in another way, this is not new, you see, because if I may sort of paint some pictures from the prophetic writings of the Old Testament. That's what I want to do. You know that the true ministry that comes from the heart of God is to dismantle everything that this world believes in. To dismantle its structures. And I don't know whether what has happened to you, you could define that all of your trust in this world, this world's ways, its educational processes, the things it believes in, whether that whole kingdom has been dismantled in your understanding in your life, so that you really are the member of another kingdom. And into that kingdom you are entering with greater and greater and greater understanding, into the kingdom of God, which is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Ghost, Romans 14, 17. Whether you are journeying further into his realm, or whether you're still, and I think I am, increasingly realizing in my life the dismantling of the kingdoms of this world, its ways and so on, capitalism, you know, as a viable alternative. Capitalism always produces rich and poor. You know, the dismantling of the kingdom and of this world. And you know, when you think of Moses, he was a prophet, wasn't he? So let's begin. I'm assuming that you're all biblically literate, and you know the roughly the history in the Old Testament, and you know that Moses was sent from the heart of God to dismantle a people numbed. with slavery, to a kingdom, to a way of looking at things. They had at last got slightly beyond their numbness and their indifference, and they were beginning to groan and cry. They were beginning to weep and long for something different. So that when God chose the time, there's not much crying in the churches today. There's not much weeping. There's not much agony. There's not much grief coming over the state first of the church. Plenty of criticism. I've been guilty of that. I was hauled over the coals about that years ago by brethren in, by pastors in Malaysia. It was around 1992. I remember them taking me aside. I may have mentioned it to you before. And I listened to them. I knew that they were right, that they observed something in my ministry, in my soul, that was defiling that which came from the Spirit. Does everybody understand that every preacher, every speaker, every true man of God, woman of God, you understand that God gives things, he wants to give them through spiritual communion with your broken heart. That's his ideal. And that even then, when you begin to speak, it comes out of your spirit and it comes through your soul. So that if your soul is not in the fully right state, you will defile that which had its origin in God, in God's Spirit. Now, that's something for you to think about very seriously. So he wants to take you and your soul, your whole being, into a deeper place with God. Without exception, I say that to every one of you. And that he will inevitably utilize circumstances, pressures, enmities, tribulations, things that will occur which have their purpose. They are his fingers. And you think of Moses, who was sent to a people who at last were beginning to come out of their numbness into a realization that they were slaves, and they began to cry and they began to groan. Oh Lord, oh God, bring us. And God heard their groaning and he sent them a messenger, a prophet. And his name was Moses. And just think about that for a minute. Just realize that when Moses came, he came to challenge the mastery of the empire. The Egyptian hegemony, to break its power, to release the captives by breaking the power of the empire. And that's what he was aiming at. That's what God was aiming at. God was aiming at the reaffirmation of his right over his people. His right over his people. And because they were his people, he had, you remember, their father Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and Jacob went down into Egypt and he went there, and it was all in the will of God, and they grew there and they became a host of people. They were still gods. And it's good for us to remember the earth is still the Lord's and the fullness thereof. And beware the empires that think that they can do with it as they will, whether it's the Chinese Empire, or whether it's the Putin Empire, or whether it is the American Empire. My brethren, God aims to judge them all. And he wants to save his people out of it. It is these ways of looking at things that, alas, is absent in many quarters in the churches. And you know how when God sent Moses at people to bring the message, the leaders at first did not believe it. They did not believe it. And they believed it even less when it began to happen, when God began to do some signs and some wonders, the plagues, you remember. And but it was his way of beginning to break the mastery of the empire, those signs and wonders. And it all peaked, as you remember, in the death of the firstborn, until in the end the mastery of Egypt was broken and the people of God were loosed, and it was very, very wonderful. And across the sea they came, and their enemies were slain in the sea, and they saw their dead bodies, and they sang. And they sang. And you know the rest of the story. And if I rush on very quickly, God was their king. You know, God was the head of the house. He loved them. And he brought them to himself. That's the kind of language he uses. I brought you to myself. Well, they didn't fully come because they still seemed to bring some of the old stuff with them. And it caused them trouble all along. They got into the land of promise. God was faithful. He got them so far as to began to possess the land of their inheritance, and then they fell away from it. You remember that too, don't you? That they never fully dealt with their enemies. They never fully passed in their journey into God. Some of them did, but not many. You can remember the name of Joshua. He did. And who's that famous fellow who had daughters were of the same quality as he was? Do you remember his name? Who said, you know, about giving him this mountain? You remember his name? Can you remember him? And those daughters of his, you know, he was one of the spies who went in with Joshua. You remember? And so some of them entered in, you know, to all that God had for them. But Many didn't, and some of the members of the tribes that they were to slay remained alive. You remember? That's why we've got the scripture, isn't it? And then you pass on, and of course you go through the history, and you go through Judges, don't you, where things get really messy, pretty horrible. And then you pass in to that lovely book of Ruth, and then you pass into the books of Samuel and Kings. And here's the people of God. They're separate. They have their own land. And you remember that, the priesthood began to fail. Their liturgy, now I'm thinking of the church, the liturgy begins to fail. People begin to get bored in the churches with the charismatic liturgy, you know, the big band and the noise. That's the charismatic liturgy. Or they get bored with this liturgy and that liturgy. And that's the kind of thing that happened in Judges and into the early chapters of the first book of Samuel. You know, and there was the liturgy, Eli and his sons and everything. The religion is defiled. And old Eli's gone blind and he's overweight. And he doesn't rebuke his sons. And you remember the story. It's vivid, and maybe you haven't thought of it this way. And the liturgy has failed. I reckon some of you may never have thought of it in those terms, but I hear it again and again. I know people who are on this Zoom and they don't go into the meeting until the music's finished. Not only because they can't stand the unreality of it, but the noise of it kills them. And they go in and sometimes they get bored out of their brains with the litany, with the liturgy of what's preached. This is serious, my brethren. And it happened in the first chapters of the book of Samuel. And there was a lady who was barren, my brethren. A lady named Hannah, who agonized over her barrenness, and no doubt spiritually agonized over the dryness. And you remember that old Eli hadn't got a clue. He thought she was drunk, that she was drunk. He didn't understand that she was beside herself with longing to be a productive woman in Israel, a mother in Israel. He didn't understand the nature of her longing. And she prayed, you remember, and God opened her womb. And when she prayed, she promised that she would give the offspring of her womb. Give me children or I die, was her heart, as it was for Rachel in the book of Genesis. Give me children. Give me spiritual children, will you, Lord? That's what's got to come in the church. That the church is supposed to be the bride of Christ that brings forth holy children unto God. Isn't it amazing? And she won't do it unless she comes like Hannah did. Oh, I've been barren, Lord. We've been barren, Lord. And dear Hannah, I'll give him to you, Lord. I'll give him to you, Lord, if you give me a son. In the midst of the dreariness of this that we're living in. Ah, and God opened a womb and Samuel came. You remember it. The prophet Samuel. Wonderful. He was just a little boy first, and he was given to God, and he was there with old Eli. You remember, in the tabernacle from a young age, and he was there, and the word of the Lord was rare in those days. And then God spoke to Samuel. And the first thing Samuel had to do was, of course, inform Eli about the death of everything was coming on him and his boys. It was finished. The old was finished. So it all began, the prophet, all began with tears. Tears in a woman. Hallelujah. And then the first message of the prophet, little Samuel, what he heard from God is all about the death of the old system. Gotta go. And you remember, of course, how Samuel ministered, and you know he was quite a man, wasn't he? And the prophet of God, and he grew, and the word of the Lord came forth, and you can read this in the first book of Samuel. And then there came the time when he got old, and his boys were not walking in the same spirit. They fell from it. And something amazing happens then. The people of God decide they want to be like the nations round about. They want to be like them. Give us a king. Samuel, give us a king. We want a king like the other nations round about. Now, this is serious. This is serious. Very serious. They're making a choice. We don't want God to be king. Now, this is, of course, what the discussion that dear Samuel. He said, no, I don't want to comply with your wish that you want a kingship over you. And, God says to him, they've not rejected you, Samuel. They've rejected me. It's a wonderful adventure to really let God be king in your life. It's a wonderful adventure. It's a chancy business. It doesn't make everything predictable. There's an unpredictable side to it all. Give us a king like the others, will you? So that we can be like the nations round about. And I'm in chapter 8 of 1 Samuel. And this is it. all the elders of Israel, verse 4, gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 5, and said to him, "Behold, you are old, and your sons do not walk in your ways. Now appoint for us a king to govern us like all the nations." But the thing displeased Samuel when they said, "Give us a king to govern us." That's what upset him. And Samuel prayed to the Lord. And the Lord said to Samuel, "Hearken to the voice of the people in all that they say to you. For they have not rejected you, but they've rejected me from being king over them. According to all the deeds which they've done to me, from the day I brought them up out of Egypt, even to this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are also doing to you. Now then, hearken to their voice. Only you shall solemnly warn them and show them the ways of the king who shall reign over them." So Samuel told all the words of the Lord to the people who were asking a king from him. He said, "These will be the ways of the king who will reign over you. He will take your sons and appoint them to be his chariots and to be his horsemen and to run after his chariots. And he will appoint for himself commanders and of thousands and commanders of fifties and some to plow his ground." And I bet you're wondering where I'm going to go with all this, aren't you? I wonder if you're wondering. You know, he'll take your daughters to be perfumers and cooks and bakers, and will take the best of your fields and vineyards and olive orchards and give them to his servants. He will take a tenth of your grain and of your vineyards and give it to his officers and to his servant. He will take your men servants and maid servants, the best of your cattle and your asses, and he will put them to his work. And so in that day you will cry out because of your king," that's verse 18, "whom you've chosen for yourselves, but the Lord will not answer you in that day." That is Solomon. How about that? Not Saul. Saul failed in other ways. David, he ruled. Solomon followed him. And at the beginning of his reign, it was good. But as his reign continued, he did exactly that. Building the house of the Lord, he turned the people into slaves. And he himself, his heart went astray. And you know, he moved into marrying many women. Political things took hold of the people of God. And the people of God who sought for kings. Can I ask you, who crucified Jesus? The teachers, the king, the kingdom, the Pharisees, the ones who'd taken leadership That's what happens. Samuel warned them, but they made a choice. They wouldn't allow God to be their real God. They wanted kings. They wanted order. They wanted shape. You know, it is remarkable as you begin to follow these things through in your thinking. Now that leads me to the book of Isaiah. So here's Isaiah. And you know that Isaiah is one of God's mighty prophets. They call him the evangelical prophet, don't they? The gospel according to Isaiah. And I go to him, and it just so happens, of course, that he comes after the Song of Solomon, the best song that was ever written. And he wrote it when he was young. But anyway, now we come to this man, Isaiah. And here you are. So we're now going to concentrate on the voice of God coming in the time of a kingdom. A kingdom. It's around about 730 BC. And, you know, he's going to prophesy, verse 1 of chapter 1, the vision of Isaiah, the son of Amos, which he saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem in the days of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, kings of Judah. That's quite a long time. Quite a long time. The last name, of course, is Hezekiah. You may remember that Hezekiah was the one, and the story's in the book of Isaiah. He was a king who did some good at the beginning and went badly wrong later on. God wanted him to die, and he wanted to live. And God gave him, and he made a choice. He said, I want to live, I want to live. And you know that he lived another 15 years. God allowed it. And during that 15 years, he begat the worst king that Judah ever had, whose name was Manasseh. That's when he generated Manasseh. You can check me up. You know, when you cling on to things that you shouldn't, it breeds what's wrong. Anyway, of course, the vision, and I want you to notice this. I want you to notice the vision, singular, that he saw over the period of what amounts to almost 50 years. One vision that he saw in the process of around 50 years. He saw something. If you were to sort of say, well, what was the vision then? He saw how rotten everything was. He saw the faithfulness of God. He saw the jealousy of God. He saw the judgments of God. He saw into the far distances. Oh, bless God. He saw into the time when all things would be made new. He saw into the time where the servant would come. He saw the coming of Jesus. He saw the victory of Jesus through pain. And he saw it was all one vision. It was all one vision. He saw the new heavens and the new earth by the time you get through to the end of his prophecy. And all of this deepening as he himself went into the journey with God. He himself into the adventure with God. And these kings came and these kings went. Kingdoms come, kingdoms go. Ah, blessed be the name of the Lord. And I want you to notice who he prophesied to first. Just look at verse 2. Might surprise you, because you might think, well, you prophesy to the church. Oh, you prophesy to the world. Who did he prophesy to? Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth, for the Lord has spoken. Sons I have reared and brought up, but they've rebelled against me. He calls on the heavens and the earth to hear. The whole earth is a living thing. The heavens are alive. See, and God says, look, O heavens and earth, pay attention to my sons, the center of my purposes are my sons, and look what they've done. Sinful nation. The ox knows its owner, the ass its master's crib, but Israel doesn't know. My people doesn't understand. Isn't it remarkable when you begin to read the Bible, the vision that he saw? Oh, we affect the whole of the creation. The creation's watching. The suns, the trees are watching me. Isn't it incredible? The stars are hearing God. He so loves his people. And I go through and I go into chapter 2 and I see this, the word which Isaiah, the son of Amos, saw concerning Judah and Jerusalem. The word that he saw. Strange language, isn't it? But this is what the prophetic thing is. It's all about mystery and the mystic. The secrets of the Lord being revealed. One of the reasons the churches are so dull is there's need of the prophetic ministry. The churches have many kings at the moment. Bosses. Administrators. And people have wanted it so. People have wanted it so. Give us a king. Give us a king. But God says, no, I want to send you a prophet. The word which Isaiah saw. Isaiah means God is salvation. Not the king is salvation. Not the eldership is salvation. Not the Pope is salvation. Not the Archbishop of Canterbury and the hierarchy is salvation. God is salvation. That's his name. Isaiah's name means that. He saw. And this is the lovely thing that he saw in chapter 2. It shall come to pass, house of the Lord shall be established as the highest of the mountains. And he sees victory. He sees victory. Blessed be the name of the Lord. And you go on through, and if you look carefully, you know, it's very wonderful. You go on down through the chapters, and you come to this chapter 5. So go on to 5. And here's Isaiah prophesying. And here he is. Are you ready for this? Verse 8, chapter 5. Woe to those who join house to house, who add field to field. He's prophesying against America. He's prophesying against Europe. He's prophesying against Bill Gates. He's prophesying against Jeff Bezos. He's prophesying against Wall Street. Woe unto those who add field to field until there's no more room. He's prophesying against the developers. He's prophesying against the government of New York. Yes, it's amazing. Prophesying against those who drink, who exploit the poor. It's prophesying against the whole construct. Amazing, amazing. It's the kingdoms of this world, you see. Woe, verse 11, rising early in the morning, strong drink, pleasure, 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 timbrel, lyre, harp, flute, feasts, but they do not regard the deeds of the Lord or see the work of his hand. Therefore, my people go into exile. Amazing. Verse 18. Woe to those who draw iniquity with cords of falsehood, who draw sin as with a cart ropes. You know, note, woe, verse 20, to those who call evil good and good evil and put darkness for light and light for darkness, wise in their own eyes. Amazing. Woe to those false judgments, injustice, injustice in the courts. Woe, woe, woe. Amazing. Isaiah prophesying, and he's challenging the status quo, and he's challenging the status quo even in the churches that drink of the same spirit, that are ever anxious about wealth and so on. But then you get to this, chapter 6. In the year that King Isaiah died, I saw also. Yes, the word also is there. If it's not in your Bible, it should be. I saw also the Lord. Sitting upon a throne. I saw also. Now you can take that as something where in the year that King Uzziah died, I also saw, or you can take it like this. I saw the word of the Lord about this, and I heard the word of the Lord and the vision about that. And I saw that things were wrong in the world, and I saw that things were wrong in society, and I saw that things were wrong in the church, and I saw that things were wrong with the music, and I saw that things were wrong with the leaderships, and I saw that there were things, and I saw, and I saw, and I saw. But in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. I also saw him high and lifted up, sitting on the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. I also saw the Lord high and lifted up. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to the other, I also saw the Lord. I could see all these other things. I could see all these other things, and they were shown me of the Lord. But in that year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. Saw him. Holy, holy, holy. I heard those seraphim. Yeah. And they were saying, they called to one another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. I got a little hint of that, you know, when I heard my brother pray about Dad in hospital at the beginning of the meeting. When he wept a little, and you know, thinking of his dad and the falls he's had, and as my brother prayed, he, ah, Lord, you've been so good, you've done this, you've done that. He also saw the Lord, and that the whole earth, you know, filled with his glory. You know, God has been glorious to you today, hasn't he? You know, BB's been out for her walk, and she's been kept, and she's been in the midst of the glory of the Lord. And the glory of the Lord's everywhere when you begin to see it. You see, the prophet needs to see. He needs perspective. He needs to see the Lord. He doesn't need simply to see this and be informed by God about this and that and the other. He doesn't need his mind to be educated about this and that. He needs to see the death of Uzziah. He needs to see the death of the hegemonies of the kingdoms. He needs to see it's all going to end, that it's a house of cards, that these republics are banana republics built upon nothing. nothing needs to see the Lord. The earth is full of his glory. He needs to hear the seraphim. He needs to hear their cry. They call to one another. Hallelujah. And it says, the foundations of the threshold shook at the voice of him who called, and the house was filled with smoke. And in the light of all this, look at what he says. And I said, woe is me. How many times that he said, woe, in chapter 5? You say, Bernard, what are you saying? No one has been brought through into God who is not brought through into his great love. You haven't come through into God until you've come through into his love. And you haven't come through into God if all you're saying is woe to this and woe to that and woe to the other. You haven't come through fully in the journey that God wants to bring you on until you see the Lord. And he reveals himself to you in such a way that you say, woe is me. Woe is me. I am lost. I'm lost without you, truly, Lord. I'm lost. I am a man of unclean lips. And I dwell in the midst of a people of... Do you remember that the man Uzziah, the king, had become a leper? Do you remember that? He was the leprous king outside. And here's God bringing his prophet inside to cleanse him from things he wasn't even aware of. To cleanse him. Oh, woe is me, for I am lost. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. I'm leprous, for mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Wonderful. Wonderful. Then verse 6, then flew one of the seraphim to me, having in his hand a burning coal, which he'd taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away. Your sin is forgiven. Oh, wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful. Sometimes I wonder, something similar to this happened to Peter. Now you remember that Jesus called Peter a couple of times when he was fishing. You remember that? No. He was fishing. He was fishing. And Peter got on with the work that the Lord gave him to do, but his mind wasn't in tune with Jesus and his heart wasn't fully in tune with Jesus. He just wasn't. And then Peter went so far as to confess, didn't he? You know, I'll die with you. I'll die with you. I'll die with you. And no, you won't. No, you won't. And then Jesus looked on him, it says, I wonder how Jesus looked at him. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. And you remember, Jesus went to the tree alone. And Peter went fishing and came in having caught nothing. And then Jesus met him on the beach. And you remember how Jesus spoke to him, you know, and now you go and feed my sheep. He sent him a second time. He sent him into the world from his wounded hand and his wounded side and his loving heart and his forgiving heart. He sent him into the world. Go and feed my lambs. Go and feed my sheep. Go on, Peter. He sent him a second time. He cleansed away all of that denial and all that, oh, that thing that Peter had done, and said, now rise up, my son, you go out and feed my sheep. Sent him a second time. Glory to God. And here's dear Isaiah. I sometimes wonder, he'd heard some kind of call from God. I'm sure he had chapters 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 had poured through his soul. Whether it had been entirely pure or not, I wonder. Or whether he defiled it a bit as it had passed from God by his spirit into Isaiah. But this time, it's going to be different, you know, because now God cleanses him. Now he sees the Lord high and lifted up. He hears the heavenly seraphim. He's touched by a live coal from off the altar. This has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away. I wonder if dear Isaiah's ministry had been a little bit defiled because he still wasn't clear of some guilt. Your guilt is taken away. Whether his ministry was a little bit defiled because he still felt some uncleanness. And now the Lord took him, wonder of wonders, and showed him. When the political things were falling apart, in the time that King Uzziah died, do you know what was happening? During that time, you can find out all to do with Assyria, and things are going to happen. One of the empires is coming in. Things are changing. Glory to God. And then his ears are tuned in a new way. Is I heard the voice of the Lord, verse 8, saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? It's lovely language, isn't it? Lovely. Now Isaiah's hearing. I've always liked the word soliloquy. I like that word, someone talking to themselves. And here's God talking to God. God talking to God. You could say God in soliloquy. God talking to God. And Isaiah hears the heart of God. Who shall I send? Who will go for us? For us. Amen, Lord. I want to go for you. I've always wanted to go for you. Always. But I fear that I've misrepresented you. And I've had to be purged. I've had to see more. I've had to see you. I've had to know your touch. I need your touch, Lord. Who shall I send? Who will go for us? Then I said, this is so sacred, my brethren. This is for every one of you. You are the blessed agent of the Lord. You are a son of God. You may feel this about yourself or that. Oh, let him show himself to you as never before. Let him show you his glorious filling of the temple. You know, that eradicates everything else, that dismantles in your thinking the hegemony of the kingdoms around you. They seem to be king. They seem to be Lord. They seem to be master. They're not. Let him show himself to you. They're not king. As swiftly as they rise, so swiftly shall they fall. Their name shall disappear. Oh, let him show himself, filling the temple, filling the whole earth. Your glory, the earth is full of his glory. I said, here am I, send me, send me. And he said, go and say to this people, hear and hear, but do not understand. See and see, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people fat and their ears heavy and shut their eyes. Are you ready for this, Isaiah? That to go from my heart and be in the midst of an indifferent people, the majority of which won't listen. The majority of which you'll be a strange sound in their ears. Are you ready for this, Isaiah? Oh, he was ready. Because he was going to go from the heart of a broken-hearted God. Yea, if his name was Jeremiah, he would weep. I want to tell you this right now, my brothers and sisters. Arguments aren't going to convince the sleepy people in the churches. Telling them off is not going to do it. It's not going to do it. I'll tell you how Jesus did it. He wept and wept and wept over the indifference and the numbness and the sleepiness and the fatness of Jerusalem. They were fat. they didn't hear. A few of them did, but only a few. And he wept over Jerusalem. If only you'd know. Do you know when he wept over Jerusalem? Within hours of them lauding him, saying, Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna. Luke 19. And they hadn't heard him. And he wept his way to Calvary, sweating great drops of blood, and he went to Calvary. The root, the stump, that's where dear Isaiah heard God say, he says, it will be a stump remain standing, and when it is felled, right at the end of chapter 6, the holy seed is the stump. That's where it all comes from, that stump, that Christ, that death. Are you ready for this, Isaiah, to go? And he said, how long, O Lord? Verse 11, until cities lie waste, without inhabitant, houses without men. Serious. Glory to God. I think of Isaiah. I think of Jeremiah, who wept God's tears. Tears will penetrate numbness. I said to a leader today, who phoned me, and we had time together. He loves his church. He's faithful. And he said, oh, what do I do? What do I do? They're not rising up. They're not responding. The young men, they're not. What do I do? And I said to him, go deeper with God yourself, my brother. Go into God more to share with him his grief over his sons, over his people, so that maybe you'll find yourself breaking in the midst of your preaching and melting with love toward the people, and the tears will do what rebukes cannot do. What a thing it is. Jeremiah was like that. God called him that way, took him in. You must never think of it as he was a weak man, a tearful fellow. He was taken into God's grief for the numbness of the people. And so the Lord is working his works in us all. I think this COVID time has been a very blessed time, don't you? Getting hold of us, bringing you into the quiet place. I remember one of the first words the Lord spoke to me when the COVID struck, you know. I remember so clearly. He said this, it comes from this book of Isaiah as well. Come, my people, enter your chambers, and shut your doors behind you. Hide yourselves for a little while until the wrath is past. For behold, the Lord is coming forth out of his place. That's the Lord. First word the Lord spoke to me almost within days of getting back from Malaysia. when the lockdown first came in this country. It's at the end of chapter 26 of Isaiah, if you want to find it. Come, my people, the 20th verse, Isaiah 26. Enter your chambers. Shut your doors behind you. Hide yourselves for a little while until the wrath is past. For behold, the Lord is coming forth out of his place. The Lord's coming forth. I believe, you know, the Lord is calling us. You know, I want to be faithful to him. I believe you do too. Will you let him take you further into himself? Will you let him take you further in? Perhaps in the midst of political upheaval, like for Isaiah, the year that King Uzziah died, it was a terrible time. They'd passed through a time of prosperity, had Judah in those days. Samaria had not yet fallen, but the warning voice was going out against Samaria, the northern kingdom. You know, there were prophets prophesying up there, and they were weeping too. And you can read them, you've got them in your book. Glory to God. And so the Lord is calling us. Amen. That's enough from me. I haven't got as far as I hope to get, but that's enough for now. And, you know, can I say this, just to kind of, one of the things, you know, there is such a thing, you do believe, don't you, that the gifts of God's Spirit and the ministries that God gives are in fact originally natural to man. That Adam was a prophet. That Adam was kingly. That Adam was priestly. You believe that what we call the gifts of the Spirit are natural to man. To be in fellowship with God and to speak his word and to rule in the midst of things is natural to man. And you do believe that these things were entirely natural to Jesus. To see with spiritual eyes, to have an uncluttered mind and uncluttered spirit, and to be granted such fellowship with God so that you could speak. And you know that sin has corrupted everything, and that there are some people, you know, some people who have certain gifts, psychic powers, and occasionally they get things right. Occasionally. There was a group of them that came in to bring three gifts. Psychic men. Men who were inquiry after things. They had hearts and abilities that were, and they came from the East. They came from the East. And they saw the star, they saw the signs. they saw the signs. But it wasn't in fellowship with God. You say, why do you say that? Because they went to the wrong place. They went to Jerusalem. They went to the pride of men. They went to the place of the king, the earthly one, the false one. You beware of those so-called prophetic ministries that say to you that you're going to have a great ministry and you're going to do this and you're going to be that and you're going to be the other. Because the Lord will say to you, I'm going to gather you to my bosom. And you're going to be crucified with me. And you're going to be broken bread and poured out wine. That's what you'll be. That's what he'll say. And you'll multiply through that. You'll multiply. And fruit will come. You see, but the psychic says, oh no, it goes to the wrong place. So I have learned. So I have learned. Then you may want to sort of, but God grant it in us that we'll move on in God. And I tell you, without hardly realizing it, something more from his heart will pour through you to others than you've ever known. Hallelujah.